Does everybody fall?
Yes.
Nobody's had too much, so you're going to fall asleep, right? Okay. If you do, please don't snore, because it might come out on the tape. All right. Anyways, we are just so thankful that you were all able to come this evening and join us for this Thanksgiving extravaganza. And we're going to have a message yet this evening, and we're also going to sing a few songs together. But first of all, the Millers have been working on a trio here lately, and Isaiah has been having his voice change over the last few years. And so if you remember the recording, he sang, what is that
called? The Lord is good to me.
Yeah, that one that we have on one of the CDs. He sang real high. Well, you'll be amazed at how his voice has changed. But we want to sing a song for you this evening that's called Thank You, Lord, for Your Blessings on Me.
Blessings.
for your blessings on me.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to ask the worshipers if they would come up. And the worshipers out there, if you would join us, if you want to stand with us, that's fine. And we're going to start off singing one of the great old hymns that many of you probably know. Great is thy faithfulness. How many of you have found God to be faithful? Amen. Thank you, Father. Great is your faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness.
How many of you could say he's been faithful to me when I've not been faithful to him? Amen, amen. That's God's mercy and that's his grace that he showers down upon his children. We're going to sing a song, and the name of it is He Knows My Name. And I'm just going to say this for those of you that perhaps have not been here before. Maybe you're not familiar with some of the songs that we sing, but He Knows My Name is taken from Scripture. Isaiah 49, verse 16, talks about how God, even though even a woman might forget her child, God will never forget you. He says, "Behold, I have graven thee upon the palms of my hands." That was thousands of years before Jesus came and his palms were pierced and the blood that came forth from those wounds cleansed us from all of our unrighteousness. So literally, your name, in a fashion, is imprinted upon the hands of God. He will never forget you. He will never forsake you. He will never leave you. If you just call upon Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. He knows my name, and he knows your name tonight.
but sometimes all we can say is all. Oh. The deepest part of yourself is worshiping.
Yet he still loves you. That's pretty powerful, isn't it? You see, we don't enunciate and proclaim our thoughts to everybody, do we? Many of them we keep inside because we know if other people heard them, they would think, oh my word, what's wrong with them? Well, there's nothing wrong that my Father hasn't already seen and that he doesn't love. In spite of his grace and his mercy, they far exceed our comprehension of him. I'm reminded of Mayor LaGuardia. I think it was back during World War II. The courts were empty because so many people had gone to serve, and so he was filling in as a judge. This was during the Depression times, I think right before World War II. And a woman was standing before him, and he said, what is the charge against this woman? Sir, she was caught stealing bread in a grocery store. The judge looked at her and he said, ma'am, what do you have to say for yourself? I'm guilty, judge. You see, my children are hungry and starving, and I just wanted to have some bread to give them. I'm talking about mercy and grace here. And Mayor LaGuardia at the time, Judge LaGuardia, looked at that woman, and he looked at the courtroom and all of the people that were in there. And he said, ma'am, he said, you are guilty by your own confession. The fine is $2. And he reached into his pocket and he took the money and he laid it out. Said, I'll pay your fine. And then he summoned one of the bailiffs. He said, I want you to take a hat. And I want you to pass it around this courtroom, and I want every person in this courtroom to put money in that hat for having a city such as this where a poor woman has to beg and steal to provide food for her children. And so they took up a collection right in the courtroom, and there was money for that woman to be able to afford groceries for I don't know how long. But you see, mercy said, you're guilty, but I'm going to have compassion on you, and I'm going to let you go. But then grace said, before you leave, I'm going to bless you. Hallelujah. That's why we serve the God that we serve. Hallelujah. He doesn't just save you. He just doesn't show mercy to you, but he showers grace upon you. Anybody here had grace showered down upon them? I know I have. I haven't deserved so many good things, and yet my God continuously pours into my life good things and wonderful things. Hallelujah. What an awesome God we serve. Heaven and earth adore him.
Your grace and mercy.
Yes. Because he just hasn't brought you through yet.
Amen.
You see, his promises are yes and amen. 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 Okay, so if you've not been brought through yet, guess what? It's not over. It's not over. God is good to his children. Amen. He'll bring you all the way through. He doesn't take you halfway through the tunnel and let it collapse down upon you. All right, he'll either take you through the mountain or he'll take you over it, but one way or another, listen, you're going to get on the other side.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. 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 I'm looking forward to that, aren't you? All right. I'm gonna say something.
Say something. We'll be over here. We'll be eating pie.
That's right.
I gave them permission to eat pie while I was up here. I said, really, what I ought to do is I ought to bring a piece of pie up here for me, but that I don't think that would be appropriate, but it sure would be nice. Well, anyways, y'all having a good time tonight? In the presence of the Lord, there is fullness, there is joy, there is laughter. Laughter doeth good like what? Like a medicine. All right, it's good to laugh. It's good to have the presence of the Lord because where the Lord is, there is joy. Not like the world has, but like he has. You know, if you're connected to the joy that comes from God, nobody can take it from you. Whether you go through hell or high water, when you're close to God, it doesn't matter anymore, does it? Because you know where you're headed. We have just participated in a wonderful banquet, haven't we? At least I think so. And I held myself back because I knew I was going to be up here and I knew we were going to be singing and, you know, you just can't overdo it. But I got stuff waiting for me in the fridge over there, okay? Now, don't judge, But I got some stuff waiting for me over there. So that's going to excite me and encourage me to preach fast and get done quick. Okay? Because I know that's what we're looking at. I'm looking at the clock right now, and I'm like, wow, we're usually done by now. But then I forgot, well, we didn't quit eating until after 7. But anyways, we just participated in a great Thanksgiving banquet. And God's been good to us, and he's enabled us to do these sorts of things together. And it's a great time of fellowship to have together. If you have your Bibles, if you want to tune in, turn in, click on it, whatever you got to do, but get to Revelation 19, starting with verse 5, and we'll start there. First of all, I just want to say, Father, I thank you for all of these people that have come out this evening. I thank you that by your hand we have been fed and we have been fed well. So, Father, I pray that now through the power and the unctioning of the Holy Spirit, that our spirits also this evening would not leave this place without being satisfied. From the rivers of living water would not be satisfied without having the manna that comes down from heaven, the bread of life. So we ask for that in Jesus' name in this place tonight. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Revelation 19, verse 5. This is what is going to occur directly after the rapture, after the church is caught up, harpazo, taken away, taken out of this world. We got an appointment, folks, to another great banquet that's going to be, I mean, this is going to be like a blink in the eye, blink of the eye compared to what's coming. Amen. And I heard a voice come out of the throne saying, praise our God, all ye servants, and all ye that fear him, both great and small. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, alleluia! For the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Hey, we're going to be singing that pretty soon. Hallelujah. The hallelujah chorus. Handles. Let us be glad. Are you glad? Let us rejoice. Let us give honor to him. For the marriage of the Lamb is come. I'm going to tell you about that in just a moment. And his wife hath made herself ready. Are you getting ready? Are you getting ready? And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. And he saith unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah and amen. The true sayings of God. More threes in the Bible. This passage of scripture talking about the marriage supper of the Lamb, the wedding supper of the Lamb. How many of you are familiar with that? You're familiar with that term? You see, when we get married, all of us are predisposed and assume that there's going to be some sort of a feast afterwards, right? And we're hoping that all the good things that we want to eat are going to be there, like some of this and that and that and that and those and these and them and this and those and these and them and them. I didn't find anything I didn't like tonight, by the way. How about you? Everything was good. Everything was tasty. Well, in the Jewish culture, here's the way it went down, and here is the picture of what is going on right now in our world and what is happening to us as partakers of it. There was the betrothal, and then there was the groom, which came for the bride at midnight, and then there was the marriage feast over many days. Beloved, in this room tonight, are you prepared? Those of you that are watching online, are you prepared? Are you ready for the groom to come at the midnight hour? I pray that you are, because that's when he's coming. The time when the Bible says will be least expected, that's when I shall make my appearance. Now, he's not going to appear to everybody in the world. Most people in the world aren't going to see him. As a matter of fact, what they're going to see is nothing when it comes to you and I that are the redeemed of the Lord. They're going to see that they were talking to us, they were looking at us, and they blinked, and we were gone. And they'd be like, wow, that's strange. They must be really quick. They ran away. Did I say something? Did I have garlic on my breath? I mean, they left. They're gone. Well, that's the way it's going to happen. And in the Bible, it tells us that there, in this scenario and in the Jewish culture, that when the groom was betrothed to the woman, that he made a deal with the family for the dowry. Y'all are familiar with that, right? You know, the bride wants to know, what is it I'm going to get out of this deal, right? And so it was no different then than it is now, except that when that happened, the groom made the deal with the family, with the bride. You're going to be this much given, and I'm going to go and prepare a home for my bride, so that when we do tie the knot, when we have the ceremony, there's going to be a home already prepared for her. It's going to be ready, and it's going to have this, and this. It's going to be furnished and everything that her little heart desires and that she's dreamed of. I'm going to try and provide that when this takes place. So the betrothal was the payment that was agreed upon by the parents of both the bride and the groom. Well, the father of the bride, in this case, our father, had made a stipulation way back in the Garden of Eden. He said, the wages of sin is death. And who will pay that? The bridegroom cometh. Jesus. He said unto the bride, he said unto you and me, my blood will be given for your redemption. Hallelujah. I'm going to give a sacrifice that enables you, my precious, beloved bride, to be able to spend all of eternity with me in the home that I am preparing for you. The expedient coming of the groom has, after the home has been prepared, John wrote this in John 14, and you're all familiar with this. We hear it a lot of times at funerals, but the real application is this, that once we who are alive are raptured out of this place, Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you, but I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and I prepare a place for you, I will come again. How many of you know he's coming again? Amen. I will come again, and I will receive you unto myself. Are you ready to be received unto him? I am. Oh, glory. That where I am, there ye may be also. Hallelujah. Forever and amen. When the home is ready that Jesus is preparing, when the time is right, Jesus, the groom, will come for his bride. Immediately, the bride, you and I, the redeemed of the Lord, we will be called forth and we will be seated in a giant banquet hall. Hallelujah. The likes of which nobody has ever seen nor even imagined. Can you imagine how ornate it's going to be? I told you the last few weeks how gold is used to pave the streets. Gold, I have to imagine, will be everywhere. Gold was used inside the tabernacle in the Old Testament to shine the light so that the little candlelight in there would illuminate the entire room. It's going to be a wonderful banquet that is spread and prepared before the bride of Christ, and we will be ushered into there. And the Bible says there were, in Matthew 25, that there were 10 virgins that were waiting with the bride, and 5 of them had oil in their lamp, and 5 of them did not. And when the bridegroom came, the 5 that had the oil in their lamps, oil signifies the anointing, the presence of the Spirit of God. Those 5, they were ready. And so they went out with the bride and they had their lights. You see, it was midnight. Nobody could see, but they had their light and they could see where they were going. And they were just following the groom off to the great banquet that had been prepared. The 5 that had no oil in their lamps, they'd not considered that they needed to have the Spirit of God, the anointing, the presence of God in their lives to attend the banquet. And so they were left behind. They couldn't go. Matter of fact, they were desperate and they tried to go to the neighbors, to other people. Can we buy some oil? Can we borrow some oil from you? The feast is occurring and we don't have anything in our lamps to get there. I'm like, no, I'm sorry. We don't have anything for you. And such will it be in the last day. But the bride's clothing, we're told in Revelation 19:8, was going to be of fine white linen. White signifies what? Purity, sinlessness, and hope, and brightness of the future. To her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. You living right for Jesus? Are you living right for God the Father? Guess what? Your garment is being woven at this very moment. The linen is being pressed. It's being made sure that it's pure and spotless. The brilliance, can you imagine the brilliance of that white garment that you're going to have on when the light of Jesus Christ hits it? We're going to be like giant incendiary fireworks displays of brilliant light shining forth like it does from the Father at this banquet, at this feast. It's going to be wonderful to look at people and say, I see your garment and how it's so full of the illumination of God, the good things, the righteousness, the things that you did for God's kingdom. They are revealed in what you are wearing. This feast, it will last the duration of the 7-year tribulation period, and I won't get into all of that, but it's going to be a banquet like no other in all of history. Some place this banquet at the end of the tribulation period, some at the beginning, others at other places. Hey, I'm for all of them. How about you? Hey, I'm about ready to have some more. That's what it's going to be. 7 years of feasting, perhaps more. Like, I can't hold that much. Well, you'll be able to there. Don't worry about it. We won't get fat. We hope. We don't want to end up looking like that cat that was up there. But that feast, that banquet, is going to be the first thing that we encounter when we leave this world in the rapture. Now, some of you are like, well, what happens if I pass away before that happens? Well, the dead in Christ are the ones who rise first, so you get to go first. Now, I'm perfectly willing to go second. Okay? I'm okay with that group going first, and we'll just follow on up. But it doesn't matter, because it's all in the twinkling of an eye. How many of you can measure the twinkling of an eye? Anybody in here? I don't think it's measurable. I think it's so fast, it's faster than the speed of light. It's like the speed of thought. So in the twinkling of an eye, we're all going to be together. And this feast is going to be a time where we have a meal together. I pray each and every one of you, each and every one of you that are watching, I pray that every one of us is together at that banquet table. Now, we might have to yell a little bit because we all got other friends. We all got other loved ones that are saved, right? And some of them might be a half mile down the table or maybe 100 miles down. Maybe my great-great-grandmother and father who love God, maybe they're going to be 1,000 miles down the table. But anyways, I might have to yell in a loud voice or run to go find them. But it's going to be a time where we get together and we just love on one another. And we say, I'm glad you made it. Hallelujah. I want to say that to as many people as possible, don't you? I'm glad you made it. Glory to God. It's by His grace, by His mercy, by His power, by His might that any of us are going to make it to that place. Amen. It's only by the blood. I heard a story of a Sunday school class that was going on, and the teacher asked the class, and it was a little bit older group, but he had a very poignant question. He said, now listen, He said, we've talked about how great God is and how he knows everything. And there is nothing hidden from him. So I want to ask you, and I'm going to ask you right now, is there anything that God cannot see? Now think. I'll give you a moment. Boy raised his hand. Said, I know something that God can't see. Oh yeah, what is it? Said, God can't see any of my sins. Because they've all been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Glory. God does not remember your sins once you have come to Jesus. Once you've repented and asked him to be your Savior. The Bible says that he removes your sin as far as the east is from the west, and that he also casts them into the sea of forgetfulness. So whatever sins that you might still have in your mind, you remember like, well, I did this and I did that. Guess what? God doesn't remember them. Isn't that cool? If they've been washed by the blood of the Lamb, they are gone. And they are gone forever. Can anybody say hallelujah? Hallelujah. Those sins, they're gone. Never, ever, ever again to be brought up for anybody to remember. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So we have some feasts and some festivals that we're going to be partaking in. And the first one is the Marriage Supper of the Lamb. But after that, if we read in the Old Testament, there were seven main feasts. They were festivals in ancient Israel that God commemorated for his people to do. And in Leviticus and several other places, Leviticus 23 specifically, but in other chapters, in other places, the Lord says that these will be remembered forever. Forever. Now, getting together and eating is fun, isn't it? Jesus thought so. God thinks so. He instituted seven feasts for people to have all throughout the year where all of his people would come together. Amen. We're going to be doing a lot of eating, a lot of feasting, a lot of praise in glory. That's not going to disappear. So for those of you that have an appetite and you're fearful that I'm not going to be able to enjoy those things that I loved here, well, you're going to be able to enjoy them more because there won't be any more diabetes. There won't be any more heart disease. There won't be any more of this and that. Whatever thing it is that you want to name, it's all going to be gone. There's going to be a presence with him of health. There's going to be a presence of him of wellness. And there's going to be an appetite, not just for food. There's going to be an appetite for more of him. Hallelujah. Bible says we shall be like him. So what were the seven feasts? I'm just going to run through these quickly and then I'll wrap this up for this evening. The seven feasts and festival. There were three in the spring, one in the summer, and three in the fall. Passover. Y'all remember that, right? The first one, Jesus' death as the perfect Lamb of God sacrificed for us. The Passover that will be commemorated, that will be celebrated forever. You will forever be thankful to Jesus for what he did for you on Mount Calvary. There will be never any end to that. Hallelujah. We will see as we are known when we get there. It'll be like, Lord, I don't know how you did it, but thank you. Thank you for saving a soul like me. Second one, the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, 7 days in the spring. Jesus, it shows us that Jesus was the sinless sacrifice. The unleavened bread was bread that didn't have any yeast in it. I heard this week that at Passover, when they were getting ready for the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, that the man of the home, the priest of the home, would take a little piece of leavened bread and he would hide it in the house somewhere. And he'd call the children in and it was a game. Like, who can find the little morsel of yeast in this house? And so they would search and they would look and look and look. And finally, when one of them found it, they would yell and scream with excitement, but nobody touched it. Nobody dared touch the thing that was unclean. So the priest would come over with a feather and he would scoop that little piece of yeasted bread into a little wooden vessel or something of that nature, and he would take it outside very carefully and he would put it in the fire and it would be gone. Perfection. Sinlessness, that's who Jesus was. And then the Feast of the Unleavened Bread after that was the Feast of the First Fruits. After Jesus rose from the dead, after 3 days and nights, there was the first fruits. Jesus was the first fruit. He was the first one to raise up from the dead in immortality. Does that sound good to anybody in here tonight? That you only have to die once and then live forever? Glory to God. The truth is, you're living forever right now. It's just your destination hasn't been decided yet if you haven't called upon Jesus as your Lord and Savior. But you are going to live forever. But the Feast of the First Fruits is the feast celebrating that people have come into relationship with Jesus Christ because he was the Passover lamb who was perfect and unblemished. And then the Feast of Weeks, or Pentecost, which was 50 days after that, was when the Holy Spirit was poured down inside of men and into our earthen vessels, and we were created to be temples unto God. Then the Feast of Trumpets came after that. Uh-oh. Somebody needs to go? Okay, we're going to be done in a moment here. Feast of the Trumpets, Rosh Hashanah. It may very well be that on the Feast of Rosh Hashanah that the rapture occurs. When the restrainer of evil will be removed, that's you and I that are filled with the Holy Spirit. And then the Day of Atonement, Christ's second coming, the middle of the feast in the fall occurs after the Feast of Trumpets. This was one day of the year when the priest went into the Holy of Holies to offer blood sacrifice on the mercy seat for the sins of all the people. It's a day of repentance and a day to ask God for forgiveness and to make amends in the future. It will be a day of God's final judgment on all non-believers. Yom Kippur points to Jesus' second coming. We will celebrate that forever in eternity. And then the last feast is the Feast of Tabernacles or Booths. It's the last feast. It's after the millennium. This is the seventh and final feast. The Jews built tents. They still do this today. You'll find that if you go to Israel, that they will put up little tents or little buildings constructed of palm fronds, and they will stay inside of these little booths, which signifies how they had to stay in tents and move about in the desert until the promised land was able to be entered into. We will celebrate that feast and that festival in glory. And we will recognize that we are now in the promised land. Glory to God. So there's going to be lots of festivals, lots of feasts, lots to do when we get to glory. You won't be floating on clouds. You might be strumming a harp if that's what you're inclined to do. But God has things for us to do, and he has all of these things planned for us. I say, everybody, get your big boy pants, get your big girl pants on, because we're going to celebrate in our Father's house. Hallelujah. Forever, over and over and over again. It's going to be family of God reunions that never, ever end. I'm looking forward to that. How about you? Hallelujah. Pray with me. Father, I thank you. I thank you that we have so much to celebrate because of what Jesus did for us. There's so much to be thankful for, and there's so much to look forward to. I pray for every person in this place, every person that hears my voice, that in the name of Jesus, they would be touched by the Holy Spirit. That if there is lack, if there is inadequacy in their lives and they need to repent of sinfulness and turn to you, Lord, that they will do that and that they will have victory then in their lives over the world, the flesh, and the devil. Yes. I pray that you would do that for these folks, Lord. Yes. I pray that you would bless them with abundance from this day forward, oh God. Yes. Help us to remember. Help us to remember every time that we eat that there are great feasts and yes. times of fellowship with other believers and with you above all others, Lord. We will be with you, tabernacling and feasting and enjoying your presence forever and ever. Thank you, Lord. I pray that there be any infirmed, any yes. with sickness yes. in this place tonight, yes. in this house, that by the might and the power of Jesus Christ, that their bodies would be touched yes. right now, yes. and that they would be healed before they leave through these doors. I pray that their bodies be strengthened, and that whatever is wrong be made right in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for that. All God's people said, amen, amen and amen. Are you washed? What a great song to close with. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Feel led to do this. If there's somebody in this place tonight, you say, Pastor Mark, all of that, it sounds almost too good to be true for me, because I know me, and I don't think there's a way that God could really include me in this thing. I'm here to tell you in the name of Jesus that he definitely wants you included in all of the celebrations throughout eternity. All he asks is that you be washed in the blood of the Lamb, in the blood of Jesus' sacrifice on Mount Calvary, that you repent of your sinfulness, turn from your wickedness, turn from those things that have a grip and have a hold of your life, turn from them and say, Jesus, I want to be washed in the blood. I don't want God to be able to see anything that I've ever done that was wrong. I want it to all be washed away. Hallelujah. If there's anybody like that tonight, nobody's looking at, would you just lift your hand for just a moment? Yes. All right. For those of you that are home, I'm going to pray. I don't believe in rote prayers for salvation. I don't believe that it's something that a pastor or a minister says, but it's something that comes from your heart. Yes. But if you lifted your hand, if inside of you, you sensed that was me, then I just want to say tonight, now, do it now. Why wait? Now is the acceptable hour of salvation. Say, Lord Jesus, I'm sorry that I made a mess of my life.
Yes.
And I'm sorry for the things that I've done, but I want to turn around.
Yes.
I want my life to be changed. I want to walk in the fullness of the love and joy and peace and kindness and goodness of Father. So I want to lay down all of my sinfulness, and I ask Jesus that you come and you just wash and cleanse my life, so that my garment, when I arrive at the wedding supper of the Lamb that it will be brilliant white and it will be clean and there will be works of goodness that I am doing on your behalf. So thank you, Jesus, for that. Thank you for cleansing me. Thank you for making me whole. Hallelujah. If you prayed that, I got to tell you, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's your name. Your name is in the palms of his hands. Your name is in the Lamb's book of life. And someday when we get to glory, you're going to look in that book, and you're going to see your name. And that name in that book means, this is my home forever.
Thank you.
Amen. And amen. All right. Yes.
For saving my soul.
Yeah. I don't know if I ever put that in here, but we know it. Thank you, Lord. Be strangers, come back and see us. Yeah, we do have two more things to do real quick. We have Veterans Day that we want to ask those of you who have served, would you just stand for a moment? Those who have, thank you for serving. All right. Okay. What branches of the military were you in? Air Force, Navy, Air Force, Army, and Air Force. All right. Thank you for your service, veterans. And we want to sing, you know, I said two things. I got three things. Help me, Lord. Help me get through this. These people, they're getting hungry. I can tell by the look in their eyes. They're looking at them pies. But we're going to sing America. And then we're going to sing Happy Birthday, because I know Ted has a birthday, right? Is it today? All right, we're going to sing Happy Birthday to you. Anyone else have a birthday this past week? Okay. Huh? Donna did? You did? Okay. So that's three birthdays. We'll sing America, then we'll sing Happy Birthday. For those of you that are visitors, and I know we have some visitors here, let me see. One, two. Had you ever been here before? You had a birthday too? You did. It's Rachel and Raquel and Ken and who else is there? What's her name? Next to you, Mary. Barbara, yes. All right. So, here's the deal. After we're done singing, you come up here. And we have a box that's full of candy bars and all kinds of gifts. If you're a first-time visitor or it was your birthday, you come up and you grab something out of this box, okay? You won't be sorry if you take a look in there. There's some pretty nice candy bars. I know he's a chocolate hound there. But anyways, let's sing America together in honor of our veterans. country. You should love this nation that you're in. You say, well, why should I? Because God had you to be born here. God had you born here for a reason. Amen. Be thankful unto him in all things. That's what my Bible says. All right. Let's sing happy birthday to these folks, and then we'll get you on out of here. And amen.